Welcome to the NBA Front Office Show, bringing you inside rumors and transactions around the league with your hosts, Keith Smith and Trevor Lane. Brought to you by LakersNation.com and CLNS Media.
Hello, everybody. Welcome back to another episode of the NBA Front Office Show. Guys, before we even dive into all of the content that we've got to go over, tons of stuff, by the way, on the NBA coming back. We've got a lot to dig into. But before we do that, quick reminder, guys, go over to Apple Podcasts, rate, review, and subscribe to this show. We love going through and reading your reviews, so please make sure you do that. You can subscribe to this show wherever you find podcasts, whether it's Apple Podcasts or Spotify or Stitcher, wherever it is, doesn't matter. Subscribe to this show. And don't forget, you can also find us on the Lakers Nation YouTube channel. If you want to check out the video version, actually get to see us talking to you. Joining me, as always, today, we've got Keith Smith. Keith, how are you doing, man?
I'm doing good, man. Hey, Kay, I know where you're all the way across the country from me. Can you smell that, though? The return of the NBA in the air?
It smells like basketball.
It does. It smells like basketball is coming. I think we're close. I'm just, you know, partially, I mean, of course, I'm thrilled basketball is here, but I'm really happy I don't look like a complete moron for, I think it was 2 weeks ago, telling you 100% basketball is coming back. I'm ready. I feel good. I feel good and validated today in that assumption.
That is looking like a pretty good bet at this point. Yeah, it looks like you were right on the money that, yes, the NBA is indeed coming back. And I'll tell you what has got me. We talked about it a couple weeks ago. I was feeling more and more confident because we saw the stars come together, right, with their powers combined, LeBron James and Anthony Davis and all the top guys in the league, right, all combined and said, yes, you know, even Steph Curry, who's on a team that may not even be there, said, yes, if there's the opportunity, we will come back and we will play. And I thought that was a great sign. Now, huge. What we're starting to hear is the details, like the little things, like, okay, when exactly can we bring in family members and things like that are starting to get discussed. And when you get to that point of discussion, that tells me that they're probably past the point of, are we coming back or not? It's more of a, yes, we're coming back, and X, Y, and Z is what we need to get through in order to make sure that happens.
Yeah, absolutely. That's what it, you know, it's funny, the details are the things that matter in this, and that's what's mm-hmm. really important. And I think for the NBA, it's easy to say we want to play for everybody, then it's a little harder of, okay, where and how and when and all those things. And I think all of those questions are now being answered. They're being lined up. We know it's going to be Walt Disney World in Florida. That's, you know, locked in. And increasingly believe, I think last time we talked, we might have still been, maybe there'll still be another site, but I don't think there's going to be. I think it's only going to be Florida. I don't think anybody else is in play here, and it's going to be Walt Disney World. And now we're starting to hear, it seems like we're creeping towards the details of all 30 teams, 16 teams, right, playoff plus, or whatever the heck we're calling all these different options. One thing I do want to say with that, and I know that's going to be part of what we talk about today, mm-hmm. but is just in case I forget there, because we all know I get all fired up and wound up, and then I just run at the mouth. But is anybody who tells you this is what the NBA plan is today, they don't know. Because the NBA doesn't know. The NBA is still trying to figure all that stuff out. I think there's things that have been eliminated, and then there are things that were never on the table. But as far as we're fully locked into this is exactly what the plan is, I don't think we're there yet. I think we're getting closer. I think they're starting to take things off the table, and that's really important. But I think we're getting really down to it, and we're getting close now. We're to a point where you can really see, like, all right, I can start mapping this thing out here, what these few months might look like moving forward. And that's really exciting.
Yeah, absolutely. They're starting to get down to those details and the nitty-gritty of it. And that's, you know, if you're fans out there, if you're following along on Twitter, if you're following Keith, you're following at Keith Smith NBA, you're following me at Trevor_Lane, or you're following any of the big news break, right? The Shams, the Woj, all those people, right? Mark Stein. There's a common thread, and that's that we are progressing towards something here. Now, as exciting as it is, and by the way, I am thrilled about the prospect of the NBA coming back, thrilled that we're kicking around all these different ideas for what it's going to look like and all of that. It's going to be amazing. I can't wait. But it looks like I'm going to have to wait a little bit longer, because right before we came on here, Shams Charania tweeted out that it looks now like it's going to be late July more that we'll actually see games start up again. And Keith, you were saying right before we came on that you're hearing the same thing.
Yeah, I'm hearing pretty similar. I think he said late July, early August. I'm hearing more late July. Now, what does late July mean? Is that, anything after the 15th of July is late July? I don't really know that. I know Disney is they're what they're loosely preparing for. And if this is the first time you're ever tuning in, let me tell you, I worked for Disney for 20 years, so that's why I have a little bit of knowledge on that side of what's going on. They're preparing to have people show up here as early as the beginning part of July, right around the 4th of July, and they're looking to bring folks in. And then it sounds like there is going to be kind of a guaranteed of a 2 week quarantine-ish practices though at Disney. That's really just the safeguard, make sure everybody got here safely and that they stay safe. And then that's when things will start to ramp up, whether there's going to be some scrimmages or preseason games or whatever they look like, and then we get into it. But I think when games that count are played, whatever that form takes. I think it's going to be more closer to that late July time, which means we're probably going to stretch this thing past Labor Day, which had always kind of been the unofficial hard stop. But what the folks at the NBA have told me is that's lessened for them. Their belief is as long as it's maybe the NBA Finals post Labor Day, they're not as concerned because they can work that schedule so that those are on weeknights, not going against football and the like. And they believe it's the NBA Finals. If you're going to ever tune in, that's the time you're going to tune in. So I think the NBA is, really gearing up for, let's call it, a late July start and something that goes sometime into, September, maybe even late September.
Okay, so I do want to talk about what that means for next season, but
Sure.
real quick, let's jump to the other side of that timetable. So with them starting up, with talking about doing training camp, say after 4th of July, that doesn't mean, and I just want to clarify this, that doesn't mean that's the first time teams are getting together. The plan is to have teams meet
Correct.
at their home sites first and then practice or do a little mini training camp there for a number of weeks. And so I want to make sure we address that because a big concern coming from the players was, do we have enough time to adequately get ready and then have our season? So that's what they're looking at doing. You would do like a mini training camp at your home site, then travel to Orlando, then you do your stuff there, and then eventually the season would start up end of July. But Keith, projecting forward, let's say the NBA
Hold
Finals.
on one
Yeah, go ahead.
second. I want to talk about that in a little bit more detail
Sure.
because I think that is important. I'm glad you brought that up. So what's going to happen here is on Friday, so in a couple days, we're
Right.
recording this on Wednesday, in a couple days they are going to do the Board of Governors call. It's expected in that call that Adam Silver is going to issue guidance to the teams to basically mandatorily recall their players right around June 1st. It may not be exactly June 1st, but right around then, to say, all right, you got to return to the home market where we're bringing you back. Or if not the home market, you got to return to here because this is where we're kind of moving our base of operations, if you will. As we're recording this, the Boston Celtics still cannot get in their facility. The state of Massachusetts still has things closed down. Now they're moving in that direction, but it's moving pretty slow. Danny Ainge himself has expressed frustration with that. He feels like if there's anywhere that's going to be safe and disinfected and taken care of, it's going to be us. We're going to be able to do it. Let us open. But they haven't been given that go ahead. So there's a big chunk of the league still that they're not there. We're only hearing the Knicks and Nets are just starting now to get back. There's still a handful of teams. So what may happen for those teams is they may gather someplace else. But what's going to happen is sometime in early to mid-June, the teams are going to get back together. They're going to make sure they test everybody, make sure everybody's in a good place. Then they're going to do some form of like a 2 week training camp in whatever their home base is, whether that's the permanent one or
Right.
this temporary. And then that's when they're going to pick up and move to Florida. 2 more weeks. So they're going to get a full 4 weeks, it sounds like, in of training, practices, get everybody feeling pretty good and ready to go. And then they will progress into the game mode. So that's what we're hearing. That has been really consistent. It's kind of, as you said, as the pieces start all flowing in that same direction, when you start hearing the same a little bit here and a little bit here, and they all start matching up, you feel pretty good that that's where it's going to go.
Right, which is absolutely critical for avoiding injury. It's important these guys get enough
Absolutely.
time to get their bodies ramped up and ready to go. Like, I mean, that, just to give you guys an example, right? So I've been quarantined here for a couple of months now. And so I haven't been doing my normal, I'm normally pretty active, out running and stuff like that. Haven't been doing that. Chased my daughter around a little bit yesterday, just, running around the house. And today my hamstring is killing me. I'm like, if I had to play a game today, I wouldn't be able to do it. And that's just a little bit of activity. I am by no means an athlete, but these guys need time. Otherwise, you're going to pick up little weird injuries that you wouldn't wouldn't otherwise.
Absolutely. They're watching the Bundesliga, right?
Yeah.
Which just returned in the soccer league over in Germany. And the big chunk of what's coming out of there is soft tissue injuries because these guys, you know, maybe came back a little quicker, you know, than they should have. So that's going to be something the NBA is going to be very mindful of. They're going to watch that very, very closely. Because the last thing you want to do is bring this whole thing back and then some superstar blows out his hamstring, you know, game one in the first half. And now all of a sudden it's like, oh man, what are we doing? Now, that's not to say that couldn't happen. Injuries do happen, but you don't need it to be him. And then, you know, six role players go down with something. And then all of a sudden you're like, oh man, this is, you know, really not working out because of things that were quite frankly avoidable if you gave him enough ramp up time.
Yeah, that's just it. It's not that you are going to make an injury free environment or anything like that. Like injuries are going to happen, but the likelihood goes up if they don't have their bodies prepared for, you know, for moving and cutting and jumping and all of the sort of stuff that you have to do out on an NBA basketball floor. But looking ahead at next season. So if the NBA finals happen after Labor Day, and let's say it's, you know, mid to late September, by the time the NBA finals finish up, what does that mean for next? Like, how quick are we going to have to see things come together for the NBA draft, for free agency, for the start of next season? And heck, is there even going to be time for a summer league? I saw that Disney has offered to hold I guess we call it a fall league.
fall league
at Disney World as well, because Vegas probably wouldn't be an option.
Yeah, so let's break down the kind of the key milestones here of what needs to happen. So let's use that mid to late September, because I think that's what we're really looking at for an end of this season. And then, yeah, I would assume at some point while this is still going on, you host the draft lottery, right? You're going to have everybody that you need, you know, pretty much at your hands. And you could do the draft lottery very easily via Zoom or, you know, whatever technology. If the NFL can hold a whole 3-day draft, you could hold a 1-night draft lottery that way pretty easy. Then you're going to have the NBA draft come, and then you're going to have free agency. So what it's starting to sound like is draft lottery happens sometime while this is going on, which isn't different. That happens in the middle of the NBA playoffs anyway. And then the draft happens maybe late September after the season is over, very first part of October. October starts the free agency. Then there is the potential of a fall league. Why Disney stepped up is the belief is maybe UNLV can't hold it because it's a campus. And if they're back on campus, which we don't, it's too early to know what that'll look like probably, but they might not be able to hold summer league the way that they usually do. And if they can't, the Disney knows the Wide World of Sports Complex, which is primarily during the year, is college and amateur athletes there in high school and in youth sports. They're not really going to be back full up and running until likely the springtime. That's just the reality of this. There's going to be enough other stuff happening in the world to get back to normal life in the fall. So it's very unlikely. So they're looking at what can we keep this momentum going, keep things going in the property. So they've offered to host that as well. But one of the things that is, with that is maybe there's that. And then I think this all but locks in. We're getting that Christmas-ish start to next season, which is one of the things I've been saying as I've been kind of making the rounds talking this whole Disney thing, and the next year always comes up, is the NBA rather is great about taking lemons and making lemonade. They are really good about that, and they're going to use this is our chance to experiment and say, all right, let's see what it looks like with this Christmas start. I don't know if I've talked about it on this show, so I apologize if I'm repeating. To do that permanently is a huge change. Has to be collectively bargained. Right. We've already heard players say, yeah, if it has to happen because of this, we get it. But permanently, no way. I want my summers. I don't want to be, you know, playing all through the summer long and those kind of things. And there's also the fact of the matter that 20 teams share a regional sports contract, network contract with a Major League Baseball team, or a network,
right,
with those teams. And that's something that has to be figured out. When that's a couple weeks in April, no big deal. There's enough day baseball. There's enough NBA off days. They make that work. But when it's, you know, you're talking, you know, all the way through July, maybe, that's a problem, and that's going to have to be figured out. So that's something that, you know, for, I think the NBA will say, hey, we had to because of circumstances. They'll make the best of it and really draw some key learning from what that looks like, just like they're going to draw these key learnings from this Disney experiment, really, and see what that looks like. And then they'll come back with a really good idea of this is what we can do moving forward.
Yeah, and that's just it. So to the first point about Christmas Day, if you're anywhere near Christmas, just start it on Christmas, right? If that's going to be your start date, because I think that would be something special. It would be a big event. It would be a big kickoff thing for the NBA. So if it's, you know, hey, we could start the league the week before. Nah, just start it on Christmas Day. That's what I'd like to see happen. And then when you're going to with the baseball situation, it's a little bit different than when you're going toe-to-toe with football. Now, I think ultimately my prediction would be that the NBA would be better off pitting themselves against baseball than they would against football.
Oh, 100%.
Right? Like that's yep. going to be the better route. So I think this Christmas
football
thing
is king.
Yeah.
Right? You and I are basketball guys, but, you know, I think we both enjoy football too, but football is king. You're not going to beat it. You're not going to take those eyes away, especially on those Saturdays and Sundays in the fall. Not a chance. And that's where, you know, it's hard for the NBA to gain traction, really, when you should be getting really fired up and excited that the season is starting. How many people, even in your life, tell you, yeah, it doesn't really start until Christmas? Right. We all hear that all the time. And that's, you know, which, you know, man, that hits me right here, man. I'm a basketball guy. I love this stuff. And you're telling me, you know, my first 2 months of my season just don't matter. And that's killer. And I think the league is conscious of that.
Yeah, I think it's something that would be a good change for them to move to Christmas because of that factor, because people are so locked in on football. And I understand it. I love the football season, too. I watch it. You know, it's must see TV. NFL football is. Going toe-to-toe with baseball, on the other hand, I think would be a better way to go. But like you said, the challenge is football is Sunday, Monday, and Thursday. And that's it, right? Baseball, teams are playing 6 games in 7 nights most of the season, right? So you've got a lot more head-to-head competition. So they have to work that out. It's not without its challenges, but I think once they do it once, maybe it'll stay. I get the players wanting to have their summers. Don't get me wrong. Summer is great and everything. But I think when you see the difference in the ratings, I think that's what's going to drive the eventual switch to say, okay, permanently, let's start Christmas Day.
What drives everything?
The
almighty
money.
Dollar, man.
The
right?
money.
That's what matters. And if it's, you know, if TNT and ESPN, NBC, you know, ABC and, I don't know, NBC, whoever else jumps in there bidding says, you know, hey, we can sell a lot more ads if all you're going against is, you know, the Yankees-Orioles game, you know, then we, you know, because this is what it looks like. Yeah, we will do that. You know, we'll do that. It's just that regional sports one. That's the one that gets tricky because it's easy to be like, well, it's the NBA, people care more. Well, that is true to some extent, but not in every market. You know, baseball is still, you know, more popular than basketball in a lot of markets. But in the end it doesn't really matter who cares more. It's about what those regional sports network contracts are, and a lot of those are, we can only be moved to the alternate channel so many times,
right,
you know, a year, and those kind of things. And that's really to protect those, you know, that late March, those 2 weeks in April where there's that overlap, that they make it work. You know, but when you start talking, you know, 3 months of overlap, that's a challenge, and that's something that they're gonna have to figure out. And it's very easy to be like, well, the NBA doesn't care. Well, the NBA may not care, but they need their games on somewhere, and that's where it really becomes important.
Yeah, they've got to be televised at some point, so we'll see how all of that works out. But Keith, let's talk a little bit about the logistics behind coming back and who's coming back, because now we're hearing more and more this idea that bringing all 30 teams back may not be the best path forward, because you're bringing that many people together, you're only increasing the risk, and then you're going to have players who probably aren't going to play. Like the Warriors probably aren't going to throw Steph Curry out there on the floor. So why have the Warriors come back? Why have these teams that are totally out of it come back? So one of the things that Adrian Wojnarowski and Ramona Shelburne just reported is that one thing that's being discussed is to bring back the 16 current playoff teams. So all 8 teams from each conference that are currently in playoff spots, plus 4 teams from the West. And these are the 4 teams, because the East is pretty locked in. These are the 4 teams that could have a legitimate chance at making a run at that 8th playoff seed, and that would be the Portland Trailblazers, who already have Damian Lillard threatening to not play if he doesn't get a shot in the playoffs.
I have thoughts on that, so I'll give them in a minute.
We'll get to that in a second. The Sacramento Kings, the New Orleans Pelicans, and the San Antonio Spurs. So that would mean bringing back 20 teams, but going back to those regional sports networks, that would mean sacrificing some money.
Yeah, it absolutely does. Now, what I would say is the 30-team model was always a bit of a pipe dream, because it was that it really, you just call it what it is. It's only a money play. It was to get there, get those guys in, satisfy those regional sports network contracts and go. And there could be something where the NBA says, hey, versus this, maybe next year we do this. Maybe next year you can simulcast as many games. You know, you can do this many more games when teams are on national TV or something. Or maybe they say, you know, hey, even though your team's not in the playoffs, you can do the first round playoff games or something. I don't know. There's a lot of things smarter people than me will work that out detail wise. But that 30 game thing was always the thing. Now, what I would say is with like the Warriors not playing Steph is every year in late March and April, which is essentially what this would be the equivalent of, superstars on bad teams don't play anyway. Yeah. That's when they have back spasms or completely different connotations, but flu-like symptoms. You know, that would take on a different meaning.
Yes, now. Obviously.
But those guys, they don't play in those games generally anyway. They might play one out of every two or three games or something like that because everybody gets it. They're, you know, you're just playing out the string here. So that part, that doesn't bother me as much as if the Warriors do end up being part of this and they don't play Steph, because he probably wasn't playing much down the stretch anyway. It doesn't really matter. But I totally understand. Get those 20 teams out. There's no reason. It's strictly a money thing. It does matter. You know, I'm the cap guy, so I fully get it. I fully understand that. But if you can find ways to work around that, and then if you can make the games that you actually do have that much more compelling, well, maybe that's what you need to do, is work. You know, that needs to be your thought process to think through that. So my thing is, I'm okay either way with 16 teams, the playoff teams. I truly believe there's enough separation in each conference that those teams have won enough over the, you know, roughly 65 games on average played that they earned those spots. I'm also okay with the, I call it playoffs plus, which is a playoffs plus those four teams and a little bit of a play-in. Now, what is interesting is I know for 100% the Orlando Magic and the Brooklyn Nets won no part of being part of that playoff plus. They have basically said, hey, we earned our way into the playoffs already. We, you know, it's not our fault that, you know, the conference stinks.
Which is fair.
Why should we be punished?
It's fair. There's no, that's the other side. People don't look at that side of it because you see Damian Lillard complaining and then these other teams wanting to get in. Understandable, but what about the teams that have paid, you know, look at the Dallas Mavericks in the 17, which is why I was shocked. That Mark Cuban came out with a plan for those spots to be up for grabs. It's surprising to me, that's for sure.
I will say on, you know, Mark Cuban and even some of the others, I think there's a very good sense, there always has been in the NBA, of rising tide lifts all boats, right? We feel good about, you know, we can really, you know, do good if, you know, if this is good for us, it's good for everybody. And if, you know, us, you know, kind of sacrificing being part of this makes sense, then let's do this for all. But yeah, so I, you know, it's funny, I've been getting asked all day yesterday of, well, what do you think they should do? And I'm like, I really waffle back and forth between just bring the 16 teams or the playoff plus, but I'm out on all 30. I just don't think it makes sense anymore.
Yeah.
I think there's just not enough time to.
I agree with that. I think for revenue purposes, it makes all they need all the revenue they can get. But other than that, I've been on board with, hey, just keep some teams home and that's fine. And I get why you would bring four from the four extra ones from the West, because there isn't as big of a gap between the Grizzlies. Like the Blazers legit feel like, hey, if we played out the remaining 16 games, we would catch the Memphis Grizzlies. We play them twice, you know, we would have an opportunity to catch up there. And so I can understand.
And Portland and New Orleans had very easy closing schedules, two of the easiest in the league. Memphis had one of the hardest in the league closing schedules. So they had that belief of, you know, we can do this. The Kings were playing great. You know, they were playing some of the best basketball they had played really in the season's second half. So they were really coming on. And, you know, so I don't have a huge issue with the idea of, you know, give those teams, you know, a legitimate shot. I do think it should be weighted in favor of Memphis some way. No matter how you do it, they do deserve the best shot to get in, because they did have, was it a 3.5 game lead, I think, or something like that, 3.5 going in. So yeah, I want to see that, you know, at least be honored in some respect. But yeah, this whole idea of doing, you know, all 30 teams and these big, you know, multi-round, you know, playing things and all that, to me that really just says, what the heck do we ever play a regular season for? Let's just have a series of tournaments throughout the year and call it good. That doesn't sit well with me. I believe the regular season has meaning, and I think it should have meaning. Now, I'm fully understanding of this is a different time, and different times call for different measures, but let's not get too crazy here. And that's why I'm also out on the 1-16 seeding. I don't like it. I don't, I'm not a big fan in this case. And a lot of times when that makes the most sense is when there's generally two or three teams in the West who have better records than the eighth seed in the East and should be in the playoffs and they're not. Then I, you know, I understand the screaming and yelling about it. This year, that's not the case. The 16 teams are the 16 teams that stands right now.
Yeah, I'm in agreement there too. I'm fine either way, whether you go 1 through 16 or just 1 through 8. I'll tell you what I think is interesting is why we are settling into this 7 through 12 tournament. And by the way, this is what, and Cuban had some variations in there and everything, but this is what Mark Cuban was talking about, was basically putting the 7th and 8th seed up for grabs, and you would have, in the West, you would have the Mavs, the Grizzlies, the Blazers, the Pelicans, Kings, and Spurs all competing for those two spots. Why? If you're looking at the standings, the Dallas Mavericks are 10 games up on the Blazers.
Yeah.
Why should their spot be up? The Mavs should be locked in.
Shouldn't be.
They have earned that. Yep. They are locked in. I think if you're going to do anything, it should be 8 through 12 and let those teams compete for that 8th spot. If you're really going to look at that Memphis Grizzlies spot and say that one is in jeopardy. The Mavs, if I was a Mavs fan right now, I would be angrier than just about any other team in the league to hear what they're considering because they have... they've earned that spot. I'm looking at the East now, and you've got the Magic are 5.5 games up, and it looks like the Nets are 6 games up. So if the Mavs suddenly found themselves on the outside looking in, that would be a clear message that the regular season just did not matter this year, and I don't think that's what the NBA wants.
And, let's be realistic, too. The NBA is a superstar-driven league. They don't want Luka home again in the playoffs. We want Luka in the playoffs. We want Kristaps Porzingis in the playoffs. We want to see, that Dallas team. Even if it's a short stay, even if they get, wiped out early by the Clippers, that's fine. Just give me them in the playoffs. So let's see what that looks like. Now, this is where I do kind of laugh about this is we're all freaking out about the eighth seed in the Western Conference. And now you can, crow and get a big head and jump around and a big smile on your face. We're going to see who's first round fodder to get stomped by the Lakers in the first round. I mean, no matter who it is, the Lakers are going to roll over them, barring, unless LeBron James has really been enjoying Taco Tuesday that much during quarantine, that he rolls in at 300 pounds and Anthony Davis is, right behind him at, pretty hefty too. Even then, I'd still probably favor the Lakers, just maybe in 5 instead of 4. But yeah, we're making a lot out of, I think this is likely to not mean very much. But then again, playoffs do still mean something. Yeah. It means something. And I think for those younger teams like New Orleans and Memphis, it would mean a lot to get into the playoffs. Sacramento as well. It would mean a lot for those young guys to get that at first experience. Even if it is a weird playoffs with no fans at Walt Disney World, it still, means something to be in there and playing in those very meaningful games, playing the same team multiple nights in a row. When you're a team that's hopeful to be there multiple years in a row starting as soon as next season.
Yeah, I mean, I look at it as okay, yes, the Lakers would be the heavy favorite over whoever is the 8th seed, whether it's the Grizzlies, Blazers, whoever. The Blazers, I think, are actually dangerous because Damian Lillard went berserk already for, 10 games this season where he was nuts. And he was unstoppable. They beat the Lakers during that stretch. So there.
This is where Trevor does the reverse jinx.
I'm doing the reverse jinx here,
make
guys.
Make sure the Lakers are fine, everybody.
I'm just saying there is, and the Blazers are a team that can say, look, we're healthy. Right now, they're finally healthy, and they could be a bigger challenge. They probably would, if they were healthy, they probably wouldn't be a 9 seed right now. So I'm saying there is, it'll be a little bit more competitive of a series. But my question is, how much of this is a let's get a shot at Zion getting into the first round and having that kind of ratings bonanza if you can get Zion versus LeBron or Zion versus Kawhi by opening things up a little bit? Is that a factor, do you think?
Yeah, I got to believe it is at least some level there. I don't think, I've heard people say, well, they're going to rig it to make sure he gets in. Well, then they would have already done that.
Right.
I think, and I'm not going to lie, but there's probably people in the league, if you could get them in a real honest moment, that would tell you, yeah, we were hoping that they would make a run here and pass and get in. But I know the NBA, Ja Morant, that Memphis team, they're a marketable team too. Bunch of young guys there and, Ja and Jaren Jackson.
But not the same
those,
level.
Those are two. No,
big
it's not
difference.
Zion. And you know, and the reality is, you know, New Orleans versus the Lakers with the trade and Anthony Davis and Zion and LeBron and all those, and Brandon Ingram going against his, you know, former team when he just had a massive breakout season. There's just storylines galore there that, you, of course, they'd love to take advantage of those, you know, if at all possible. So that's interesting, you know, and I don't think they even would, you know, mind the whole idea of, you know, hey, maybe we, you know, shuttle one of those teams. We you know, involve the Nets and the Magic in this, and maybe we get Memphis and New Orleans in, and Damian Lillard in, you know, and the Nets fall out, and, you know, and the Nets without, because I think it's a complete pipe dream that KD and Kyrie play. I know I tweeted that, but that was more having some fun there. And I know it's so funny because people are like, well, if they're playing the Lakers, they're playing. And it's like,
that's what I saw too.
Yeah, that doesn't make any difference. No. If they're playing, they're playing. It's they're not going to play, though, I don't think. I just think with the nature of what this is in the ramp-up period and all that, that's a multi-year investment. They're not going to risk any sort of, you know, trouble. Can you imagine Kevin Durant comes back, and then all of a sudden we're rolling into next year, and they're like, yeah, he's got some Achilles soreness after playing in Orlando for 2 weeks. You know, like, that would be a huge problem. So there, I would be surprised, but you know, maybe, you know, and then the Magic, you know, I mean, they're the team here that I cover, and, you know, they're without a couple guys, and if it's like, hey, you're just, you know, going to get rolled over by the Bucks, maybe we'd rather have Zion in there playing against Giannis for four games, and he gets rolled over. Right. So I get it from that side, and I think the NBA, you know, again, they're going to take these lemons, and they're going to make lemonade out of it and experiment and have a little bit of fun here and, you know, see what this looks like. But, you know, for me, it's already weird. I don't want it to be too weird. I, you know, me and you both love soccer. We're soccer guys. We both love, especially the World Cup. Get this group stage World Cup stuff out of here. I don't want it anywhere near it. I hate it so much. You know, I would like it if we knew all along that's what the whole deal was. Mm-hmm. But right now, no way. I don't want anything where the Bucks have to potentially go through, you know, the Clippers and, you know, other teams. Like, that's why I don't like the 1-16. You know, I want it. You know, give me a little more traditional. What's funny is I talked to someone from the league, and his exact response verbatim was, dude, we have so much other crap to even figure out to pull this off. I would really like to have one thing that's just simple and what it always is.
Yeah.
And I think that in a way there's some sense to that with the players, the coaches, and everybody else of, you know, hey, I want to do this. I talked to one coach who said, we already started doing our playoff prep, assuming we're coming back with a limited regular season or nothing. We did not prep for the other conference.
Right.
We didn't do any of that right now. Now, there's still, you know, there's a month, 2 months before we're going to play or anything, so that's still plenty of time. But, yeah, I just, you know, give me the normal East-West brackets and let's go. If there's a minor, you know, bump for the play-in, you know, I'm fine with that. I have no issue.
Yeah, I mean, one of the benefits of bringing sports back in general, whether it's basketball, baseball, soccer, whatever, is to provide that little bit of normalcy to the general public. And so to throw something crazy out there, like the group stage thing, it's just too big of a departure. And you know what, like, overall, I don't hate the idea if that's the plan totally, because I like the World Cup. I like the upsets that get thrown in and the interesting matchups. And there's the idea floating around of letting the top tiered team for each group pick their opponent, do a draft of their
Okay, that, can you imagine that?
That would be fun too. But I think that what you're doing, if you're the NBA, then is the more you change things, the more you increase the likelihood of an upset and a team sneaking through that maybe shouldn't, and one of your other teams, one of your strong teams, getting knocked off early. And then you bring up that whole asterisk thing again, where if you wind up with some fluky champion this year, that's where things get a little dicey from the league's perspective.
Yeah, and people are, you know, there's already going to be people who think this is completely invalidated in that. And I tend to believe it's more of, if the Lakers win and you don't like the Lakers, you don't think it's legit. If the Bucks win and you don't like the Bucks, you don't think it's legit. You know, if you like either one of those teams, you're going to fight to the death that was a meaningful championship. For me, it matters. Everybody's in the same boat. And I kind of like what Zach Lowe said. I think it was on one of his podcasts of, you know, this championship might be hard to get. Yeah. Because there's no lift of the home court. You know, you're going to have gone through all of this nonsense over the last couple months. And that doesn't mean that we shouldn't have gone through it, because we probably should have done better as a country, but that's a different whole podcast.
That's a whole different story.
It was, you know, the craziness, let's call it that, you know, the last couple months. And then you come in and you're winning all these playoff games that are centrally neutral site games. And you run this gauntlet. Yeah, that's a worthy champion to me. But you start doing things like, you know, oh, we're going to do this, and there'll be some form of single eliminations to lead into this, and then it'll, you know, we'll get down to the last two rounds that'll have, you know, the main teams left and those kind of things. I don't know, none of those things really sit overly good with me. I just, you know, I'm fine if we do something to determine that last spot in the West. Maybe I'm okay if you bump one of those East teams out as well, if you involve them. That's not the end of the world. But yeah, let's just move forward, you know, with his normal playoff seven game series and go. If we got to do five in the first round, not the end of the world. You know, there's a lot of, you know, push to that should be the way it is anyway. But yeah, I don't want this other crazy stuff. Not now. But what would be fun is maybe that's the idea for the midseason tournament.
Yeah. Absolutely.
You know, maybe that's the way to do that. You know, that could be a lot of fun. You know, do it out that way and, you know, do those kind of things and, you know, put some, you know, kind of fun odds on that or something and, you know, maybe make that really fun. I like the idea in general. I just don't like it to resume this particular NBA season.
It's a good concept in general. It's fun. It's exciting. I like it. I hadn't thought about the midseason tournament before, Keith. I think that's brilliant. I'd love to see that take place. But for right now,
let me tell you why that's top of mind real quick on that midseason tournament. So Disney, from the Disney perspective here, is one of their things is they've lost now their only professional sports connection. The Atlanta Braves, who did spring training here since the sports complex opened, have left. They've opened their own facility and they've moved away. So that was Disney's last connection. They had the Bucks for training camp here, the Tampa Bay Buccaneers, for a couple of years. They had Major League Soccer. Well, Orlando City wasn't Major League Soccer yet, but they were moving up those ranks. They played there. They had the NBA Draft Combine there for a couple years before moved to Chicago. Magic hosted their training camp. Disney is really looking at this as this is our opportunity to really kind of show off and show, hey, we can do this. We can really host this, and this is a great event. And there's already these kind of stars in the eyes of, you know, what if every January it's cold in 90% of the NBA markets? Why don't you all come down to Florida? We'll do this midseason tournament for a couple weeks, bring everybody in. We'll have some fun, you know, play through this thing and see what it looks like. We know Adam Silver has a lot of passion around doing something like that, where, you know, that would add, you know, some semblance to the regular season. And I think, you know, that's something that Disney's really looking to prove, you know, hey, we can do this and we can do this in a big way. And let us be a, you know, kind of a more of a permanent partner to you than just, you know, this group of people who kind of came in to save the day.
Yeah. And I think that's a great idea. I'd love to see it happen, especially with now that we know that Disney is a legitimate site, someplace that teams can all go, everybody could stay. It would be great. I would love to see it happen, but again, in the future, especially given, like, look what you've done to these top tier teams already, you know, and obviously I'm going to be biased because it's, you know, the Lakers, but also the Bucks, the Clippers, you know, the Raptors, all these teams. Home court advantage doesn't exist.
He cuts it off right at the Celtics.
Did I cut it off at the Celtics? That was not intentional.
Right there, yeah.
That was not intentional.
I see how it goes. No, it's all good.
That was not intentional, but probably somewhere in my soul it was intentional. But
oh, I'm sure. Yeah. Real deep down, like a slight apricot. That's right. Into your soul, yeah, sure.
That's right. Hey, come on. I don't wear green, Keith. You know?
Yeah, man, I see green in that whole office.
That's right. But if you get do that to those teams, you're already, you know, but just by moving it to Orlando, they have already lost home court advantage, right? So that doesn't exist anymore. So what they've fought for, you know, the majority of the season to get is gone. You change things up too much on them now, and you make an upset even more likely. I think it's just doing a disservice to those teams that have fought so hard for those top seeds. But let's jump to Disney World, because here's the thing, and this is all over the headlines right now. Disney World getting ready to reopen, and instantly my first thought, and I've seen this going around on Twitter a bunch, is what does that mean for the NBA if the Disney parks are suddenly packed with people? And so Keith, you're the guy to talk to about this. So what exactly does that mean logistically once Disney World reopens for trying to get NBA players there as well?
Basically means this. Zero.
Nothing. Okay.
There's very, very little impact. You know, Walt Disney World, massive property. I repeat this repeatedly, 39 square miles, twice the size of Manhattan, roughly the size of San Francisco. To put it in terms that my simple brain really understands, 20 minutes is what it takes me to drive from the end of the property that I live on to the other end of the property in the car with no traffic. That's how big the property is. It is absolutely huge. The ESPN Wide World Sports Complex complex. And if anybody wants to see it, it's on my Twitter timeline. I've retweeted it a handful of times, so it should be pretty easy to find. I put a property map up, and then I put it overlaid on New York City to get an idea of the, you know, just the immense size. But the sports complex is located at the extreme south end of the property. In addition to that, there's about, I'm guessing it's roughly a quarter mile driveway down into the sports complex before you're anywhere close to buildings or anything. Disney will have that thing locked down with Disney security, as well as the sheriffs here in Orange and Osceola counties who work with Disney. They will be there as well. I jokingly said, no one is going to stumble in there and be like, oh, I was just looking for Space Mountain. Like, that's not going to happen, right? It is. That's going to be it. And it is really far away from the theme parks. You're not anywhere close. Now the Magic Kingdom, that's going to open first, along with Animal Kingdom. Those are going to open on July 11th. And then July 15th, we are going to see Epcot and Hollywood Studios open. That'll open right as the NBA is getting here, getting started, whatever the case is. But I have been told by multiple folks with Disney, it was part of their proposal to the NBA was, we will be opening our theme parks to paying guests. You know, that is just, you know, the reality. Disney can't stay closed, right, you know, that much longer than others. You know, Universal Studios, which is a competitor right in the area, they're reopening about a month earlier. They're going to open in early June. SeaWorld is going to open in early June. Disney's going to be a little more cautious. Right. They've got a little more things to figure out and work through, but they're going to open, you know, roughly a month later. They're not going to stay closed just for the NBA. As basketball people, we think, you know, the NBA way, way up
the
here.
The world revolves around the NBA.
You can't even see my hand, right? It's way up above and off screen. You know, it is, you know, it's bigger than the NBA. And so what Disney is going to do is they're going to, you know, open up, and then that leads into, will the NBA players be allowed to go? And I think that's going to be a lot of up to the NBA. They're, you know, Florida is really out of, you know, out of this quarantine shelter world. But I think, you know, back to talking to players, well, a lot of the players are, this is a business trip. We're going there to win a championship. We're not going there to do, you know, anything but that. So we are really, you know, our goal is to get there and win. You know, and they do not want to have, you know, the 10th or 12th man on the roster goes out, you know, whether it's at Disney or somewhere else in the area, and comes back and gets people sick. And then all of a sudden, you know, they're knocked out of this. They're treating it more there. So I think you're going to see a lot of self-policing, and I think you're not going to have these issues of these. So as far as Disney reopening impact on the NBA, I'd say it's, you know, somewhere, you know, just north as much.
Well, you know, Keith, that's good to hear. First of all, that's happening. But you didn't know this, but as you were talking there, you started to cut in and out just a little bit. I think our connection must have got mixed up. So our YouTube viewers get to see your image size just went like shrunk down and then blew up. It was like you were Ant-Man, right? It just shrunk down. Man. Then you were super-sized, Keith, for a little bit. So they got to see me resizing your image there. So that was a lot of fun.
Funny, you know what's going on here right now in Florida, where I am, just off Disney property, we have these crazy thunderstorms rolling through, which is not uncommon for us, and that's probably why my connection may not be great right at the moment.
Well, we survived it in any event. Last thing, I want to finish up with this, because you never got back around to it. Damian Lillard threatening to sit out if the Portland Trail Blazers don't get a chance to compete for the NBA playoffs. Give us your thoughts.
Yeah, so I think it's a lot akin to what LeBron said when this was all first starting back in March of, if there's no fans, I'm not playing. Mm-hmm. And then within a day or two, he was like, it was heat of the moment. You know, I play for the fans, you know, and he walked it back, and clearly he's going to play without fans present. I think it's very similar to that for Damian Lillard. I think there is a, you know, mindset there of, you know, he probably spoke in passionate in the heat of the moment of, I'm not going to, you know, play if there's nothing to play for. But I can also understand that mindset. I understand that mindset, you know, very clearly from him of, yeah, well, what is the point then for a guy like him? He's, you know, well, what's the point to go out there and risk injury if it means absolutely nothing but money? But, you know, quite frankly, the NBA, again, they all look out for each other in the NBA, I think more so than a lot of other sports. And, you know, if the money is the motivator there, then I think they're going to do, you know, the best they can to try and take care of that for each other. So I wouldn't be, you know, fully surprised if they, you know, if he does play, but I also wouldn't be shocked if he doesn't play. But I, but I'm going to say this, if Portland is here, they're only here because I have a legitimate shot at getting in, and then he'll play.
You think so? If let's say the NBA, in an attempt to bring back revenue, right? They bring back just 16 teams, right? The top 8 teams in each conference, they say, sorry, everybody else, but we're going to do some exhibition games to fulfill your TV rights deals. You think that good portions of teams would just stay, and they wouldn't even bother bringing them?
Yeah, potentially. Okay. I think you could have that. I think, you know, if there's no, if it's just, you know, we're just going to play out the string here. Again, that goes back to what I said, March, April, every year when teams are playing out the string, if that's what it is, that's, yeah, you know, what it is. But, you know, if Portland's involved, Portland's only going to be here. They're only 3 games out. They're going to have some chance to get back into this thing one way or another. So I think, you know, I get where he's coming from. And my guess is, you know, that was, you know, said in, you know, in the moment, and I don't blame him. You know, I have a hard time finding a real argument against what he said.
I mean, it's his best way to get his point across, right? It's the biggest card that he's got. Well, hey, if you don't do this, then I'm not going to be there, right?
Yeah, so that's, yeah, absolutely.
And that's it. Yeah. So, yep. And I understand it. Understand it from his perspective. He wants to have that chance, which makes a lot of sense. But I don't think it's going to be. I think we're progressing towards some type, whether it's a group stage thing or whether it's a little mini tournament. I think there is going to be some sort of play-in situation for those bubble teams.
I'm with you. You know, I like to end our shows apparently with big, you know, wild predictions that maybe come true. We're going to do we're going to do playoff plus. It's going to be those 20 teams that come in. Now, what that looks like, I don't exactly, you know yet, but I think that's where it's going. Just all the things, you know, we're seeing reported, things I'm hearing, I think that's where we're going, is we're going to see playoffs plus, and those teams that are in the mix in the West are going to have a chance.
Yeah, agreed. Feels like that.
I didn't really go crazy on that one, did I? I should have done something bigger.
You need to like slam the desk 100%, right, lock it in, guaranteed. This is what's happening, and then go ahead and make some, say like the Spurs are going to be the champion or something like that. That would be a really bold prediction there from you, Keith.
Sorry, I probably just dropped the whole market for us, but man, I don't want them to get in. Like I'm bored with the Spurs, you know, and I'm out, you know, I'm out, you know, I don't, you know, give me one of those young teams. I want to go in. Let me see one of those young teams get stomped in 4 or 5 games by the Lakers. At least it'll be fun. So there's my prediction part of it.
there's your prediction. I'll take it. I hope you're right on that one, just like you were right on the previous thing about the NBA season coming back. All right, guys, we'll wrap things up there. Again, thank you guys for watching. Make sure you are following the show at Front Office Show on Twitter. Don't forget to rate, review, and subscribe on Apple Podcasts. You can follow Keith at Keith Smith NBA on Twitter. You can follow me at Trevor_Lane on Twitter or at TrevorLaneNBA on Instagram. Keith, good one. Let's do this again next week.
Yeah, that's it. I'm hoping, man, we're going to, let's say maybe 2 weeks away, we're going to be able to actually start breaking down the playoff matchups.
Yeah,
then it's going to be really exciting. Then it's going to be, you know, really where we're back at that point. I'm super excited. And then at that point too, I think for really what we do on this show, we'll have a really good sense of who's not going. And then we can really start down our offseason preview path, which is going to be fun too. And then we'll start to get a little bit more sense of the salary cap and all that stuff. But yeah, man, I'm pumped. We're almost there. My excitement. I'm a little more muted today, but it's been a long day. Been a long couple of days. I've been talking a lot about NBA and Disney World and all that. But my excitement level is here, man. It's way up there, and it's a, you know, I'm pumped. I can't wait. And absolutely, what Trevor said. Please go on, ratings and reviews. It'll only help us. Tell a friend as well if you enjoy the show. And you know, I think 4 straight weeks now we've done this, and that's our plan now. We're in a good rhythm, and I think we found some stuff that works, and we're going to keep coming and doing this, you know, as often as we can. And then we've got some cool stuff planned that we're not ready to share yet. We've talked about for what could happen, but right now the focus is on just getting the league back and talking about all that stuff. But yeah, absolutely, please tell everybody, ratings and reviews, 5 stars, and you know, if not 5 stars, tell us why. Tell us what you don't like, and we'll do our best to be better, I guess, with that. I can't change the way I look. I apologize, that can't happen. Trevor carries the looks out of the show.
I'm not sure about that, Keith, but let's if you do give us a 5-star review, let us know. We'll print it out. I'll put it up on my refrigerator and right next to my daughter's schoolwork and everything. It'll be like my grades will be going up there. So yeah. So.
I love it. My daughter just finished fourth grade today. Last day, fourth grade. Shout out to Bella. She finished fourth grade, moving on to the fifth grade. And I'll do the same, man. I'll print out your review. I'll tack it right to the fridge. And you know, and then if you give us really nice stuff, man, we'll read them on here. And we'll do that. We're not too proud. Yeah, we'll read those things. You know, make ourselves feel good. Gives us a little bit of a boost.
For sure. For sure. A little shot in the arm, which by the way, guys, just like he said, he's getting fired up. I'm getting fired up because NBA basketball is coming back, even if it's end of July. That's still, it's going to give us a ton to talk about. I'm thrilled. Here we go. All right, guys, that's it for today. Hope everybody has a great rest of your week. Stay safe, and we'll see you later.